And so we're hoping that by mid-March, the money will start coming in, and we'll be, by March, late March, we'll be able to start distributing people their money. And people get money in three categories. Everyone is entitled to a minimum of $1,000, what we call indignity damages. It's just the pain and obnoxiousness of living for 93 days. And I just want to add one thing. This is the story that drives me the most crazy, is that when the pipes froze and they turned off the water, people had no access to any water. But when the water came back on, sewer water came up through certain people's showers and flooded the place. And people didn't even have money to buy new mattresses. I mean, okay, that one does it for me. Okay, so, and the other one is that we had a meeting recently with one of the residents, and this woman said to us, I saved all my money. I bought my home. And now this man gets to just say, I'm closing the park. I'm sorry, move out, you got 6 months. And she said, I'm either going to be a tenant, which I've not been for a long time, or I'm gonna be homeless if I can't find a place. Because people, there's also a stigma here that people say, where have you been living? I've been living in, you know, Sarita. Boop, nope, we have no vacancies. I mean, it's really hard to find places here. And so, anyways, we got a minimum of $1,000 for indignity damages. We got money for people who own their trailers, and the trailers were continually devalued, and so they get some compensation for the devaluation. And other people actually had receipts of, like, I know I spent this much money on water, I spent this much money on a hotel. And many people didn't have the money to do that, so they don't have receipts. And also, the one thing that I have to say was the community has been really a lot of outreaching, whether it's carrying water, or it's donating money for water, or it's a variety of those, or looking for housing and looking for grants. I mean, there's been individuals, there's been agencies, there have been government officials, all have tried to rally to help these people. But what's really clear at the end of it is that we have a problem with really quality, low-income housing here in Latah County, and it's really difficult for those people remaining to try and find a place to live. And so they have to be out by June 5th. Many of them have left already. I'm not sure exactly what's going to happen to the rest of them and how they're going to find housing. And they're homeowners. The majority of the people who are still there own their trailers, and the majority of those trailers can't be moved. Well, I would say maybe there's one or two that may be moved, but I doubt that as well. It's not a cost-benefit analysis on it, and other people moved in and did additions on it, it's not really working. So we kind of have a couple of questions left here, is what happens to those residents that are still there? Where will they go? What happens to these homes? Who gets access to them? And what happens to the park? And I think those are just open-ended questions that everybody's afraid that somehow he's gonna reopen it. I will say McGar is very ill right now, and he's in hospice. So I want to just say a couple of things that are highlights of the case for me that really stood out. One is the need for quality low-income housing in this area, and a real need to keep, as well as it can happen, landlords, whether they're mobile homes or not, accountable. And one of the difficulties with the mobile home park is it's private. And so how does the county and the city work on that front? The other thing is that as a professor at the university, it made me aware of and thankful for the value of public education, because for over 4 years now, we have had students working on this case, and 24 students have learned a lot about low-income housing, manipulation, abuse, neglect, and the legal process, and keeping people accountable. And so I want to end with just the other thing is that we really have a good community who have come around a lot, but it's not enough.
Thank you for that. I guess I'll inject from my standpoint, the county commissioner's standpoint, what we did. Everybody's heard about the red tags. There's been a lot of talk about the red tags. What we started doing in February of 14, I believe right after that long stretch without the water is, we started red tagging the trailers, A, that were structurally unsafe to be in, and would be anytime a person moved out of a trailer, one of the mobile homes, we would put a red tag on the trailer, and the justification for the red tags were until the following actions have been taken: to provide water supply that is adequate for all fixtures and function properly and is maintained free of all contamination, and to provide, and the second, well, there's three, provide, provide proof from the Department of Environmental Quality that both the water supply system and the sewage disposal systems are fully functional and all violations have been abated. And then there was another piece we'd put in there at the time, it was important about that, that all court and legal actions we've taken were corrected and taken care of. The court and legal actions, later we had decided that we, you know, if the court cases were still going on, we could probably maybe start taking the red tags off. What was important to us, the county commissioners, is the water and the sewage. There was raw sewage running on the ground out there, she said. There was raw sewage coming into people's homes. Steve will tell you here in a minute, any home without running portable water is, any person living in a home with no potable water is considered homeless by Idaho code. The idea behind the tags was to expose as few people as possible to the coliform and the raw sewage on the ground and the other issues that were going on out there. When we started red tagging the trailers, there were, somebody's going to correct me, I'm sure, but I believe there were 320 some odd people living out there. Last number we heard, there was 90 or 100 people living out there. People, as the people would move out of a trailer, would red tag it, nobody would be allowed to move back in. The idea, again, was to expose as few people as possible to that, to them, conditions that were out there. The red tags did their job as far as that goes. So I'd like to also add, I've always said that Syringa provides it fills a need. Syringa Trailer Court does fill a need. There are people who live out there who have no place else to live. There are people who live out there that own, the only thing they own in the world is their $5,000 or $2,000 or $1,000 mobile home. That's all they have, as you mentioned earlier. So Syringa does provide, it fills a niche, so to speak. It fills a need in Lake Tahoe County and in the city of Moscow. So what's going to happen after this? I think we're in a little bit of uncharted waters. You know, we'll take a look at, you said it earlier, it's private property with private trailers on it. The county doesn't have a whole lot of working room to do that, except to address issues as they come up, and we'll do that as best we can. So as far as hauling water, you're right, Elsie. Tom Lamar and I haul, I can't even count how many gallons of water we hauled out there. But somebody would donate to buy the water, and you're right, local committee groups, Idaho Ice, got to where they were selling water for $1 a gallon or something like that. Somebody donated $1,000. Tom and I would grab the county one ton and run out and grab 1,000 gallons of water and run out there.
Problem is, some of that water is still sitting in the
that's what I hear.
In the rec center, because they put it in there and they locked it up, but then they don't have a manager. So I say your efforts were great. We saw those pictures and we appreciate that, but access to the water was somewhat of a difficulty for people.
I've driven the Troy fire truck. You all know I'm on a volunteer for Troy fire. I've driven the Troy water tanker from Troy many times full of water and hauled it out there to clean out pipes, and they couldn't drink it, but we hauled thousands and thousands of gallons of water to help clean out the sewage lines and the drainage ditches and stuff out there with the Troy tanker. So Troy, city of Troy's helped out a lot, but in the city of Moscow too, we arranged for a portable water truck that came up from Lewiston, and I don't know, a week straight, and they would fill the cistern when the wells were down to keep the water flowing as best they could. So anyway, as from the county level, you're right, we got a lot of great people in this community, did a lot of things that they could do to help those people out as much as we could. So I'm sure there'll be questions at the end, so I'm going to turn it over to Steve.
Dave?
Yeah.
When was the first red tag issued, and how many did you ultimately issue?
First red tag, I was going to grab the map on the way out the door. The first red tag was issued in February of 14.
Yeah. February 14?
February of 2014. I don't know the date, second or something like that. There were... I'm going to give you some numbers. I'm going to shoot from the hip here. There are 90, I believe 95 trailers out there. Am I close?
97
trailers out there. I think 60 or 70 of them are red tagged, am I close?
Yeah, I, right now, there's probably less than 30 units that are still occupied.
So over half now.
Way over half.
Way over half, and the difficulty is when people move out, they also can't move their trailers, so people, either they strip the trailer, or someone else comes in and is a vagrant and they strip the trailer, so now it really looks much worse than it ever looked ever.
Yeah, so.
So over, between half and two-thirds of the trailers are now.
Two-thirds, unoccupied.
Yeah, are unoccupiable, like the red tags, or, and some of them were red tagged because of structure, not just because of the water and sewer, some of them are caved in roofs and that sort of thing. Steve, I'll let you go and take a look.
We've helped folks in Salina for years, years and years. When water was lost, 14, actually one household did move out and move into one of our programs where they had to be literally homeless before considered, and have a disability. So one household did take that time to move out. Through the discussions with the folks, there was continual hope that it would pass. Even here recently getting a call, you know, is this going to change? Can we stay in our home here? We put on a fair a couple months ago for all the folks in Soringa. I brought in all the service providers in the community that have different things to offer. What I encountered was everybody I met owned their trailer, and everyone I met was not income eligible for any help from my side. I was able to procure a grant that I've set aside strictly for those folks of about $20,000. I don't know how many households I'll be able to help. Now, I'll determine my breakdown per household, but they have to be income eligible, and I can't do anything with them until 2 weeks until they're evicted. Federal laws dictate to me that, you know, if they have an eviction notice, which basically this is I can't do anything until 2 weeks beforehand. And then there's another layer going on now within the state system of homelessness, is they have to then call a specific number to be screened to determine their level of eligibility. That also has an impact on who gets service. So, but I've set aside the 20,000. Unitarians also have donated 2,000 towards it that I'm holding on to. And I'm asking people that are there to start calling in just to get that feel for the screening process. Because there, what happens now until then, things can change in their incomes. But income eligibility would be for a single individual, would be about making $10.17 an hour or less. And then if you have a second individual, it goes up by about $2,300. So, and if there are people squatting out there, I won't be able to help them because they would need to have a lease agreement in order for me to help them. So
nobody has a lease. Oh, now they do.
Some of them, I believe, would have some.
Yeah, now they do.
And then with the trailers themselves, as Maureen said, there was an owner of a trailer court that approached me about offering folks to provide 3 months free rent of lot space or help carry some alone. But through different discussions, like Dave said, a minimum of $5,000 to move. I know the county did waive the fee that if anybody had back taxes, I think it was, and they were going like down the Lewiston grade, they wouldn't be held up there. They could go somewhere else, but the cost to move. And then they have an inspection beforehand to determine whether they're eligible to be moved, which runs about $300 to $500. Now, I can help with that part, but you know, if let's say four households are left and I have the 20,000, I could potentially help them move the trailers, but you know, I'm not advocating that because I'm going to split it up amongst how many are left that qualify. Unfortunately, there is a church group too that's approached me about doing a GoFundMe and asked if I would steward the money if they raised them. I said absolutely, explain the county process. So there is some interest in the community to help. Those funds could be used for somebody else, but then, you know, like $2,000 and I have 20 households that are income eligible, $2,000 amongst them is not going to be very much. And so it's kind of difficult from my side. There are not very many trailer spots left. The long ones, there aren't any of those. I did an inventory, I think it was in December, the housing available in our community was zip. The only housing that was available were, what was it? It was a slum.